Harper Audio presents Mariam Sharma Hits the Road by Sheba Karim, performed by Soneela Nankani. 1.
Your brother has just the right amount of chest hair,
Umar observed.
Nice spread on top, thick line down the middle.
My brother, Shoaib, was half naked and lunging across the living room, heavy weights in each hand. A mere year ago, Shoaib had been an annoying, scrawny, pimply 15-year-old. Now he was 16 and even more annoying, but also chiseled, broad-shouldered, smooth-complexioned, and apparently perfectly hirsute. When he's watching TV and thinks no one's looking, he digs at his nose with his middle finger and flicks it behind the couch, I said.
Mmm,
Umar said. Did you even hear me?
What?
My phone began to vibrate. It's Ghaz, I said, answering it on speaker. Ghaz, are you back home from NYU yet? And did Umar tell you he got off the waitlist at Cornell? Hurry up and join us so I don't have to drink to him alone. Listen, Ghaz said. Something major happened.
What?
Umar asked, his gaze still fixed on Shoaib.
CVS sold out of Jolin? Your favorite froyo place ran out of cake batter?
No, no. You guys. This is serious. This got Umar's attention. For Ghaz not to joke back, something really had to be wrong.
What happened?
He said. She took an audible breath. So remember when Brooklyn Attire came to campus and I tried out to be in one of their ads?
Yeah, and you got picked,
Umar recalled.
They wanted you to wear a thong, but in a rare moment of caution, you insisted on boy shorts. Did you end up in their catalog?
No,
she said.
Ah, that explained her distress. I'm sorry, I consoled her. They obviously have no taste.
But maybe it's better,
Umar offered.
Someone in the community might have seen the catalog. I mean, what would you have done if your parents found out?
I didn't say they didn't use me, she said, bristling.
Then what?
I asked. I'm not in the catalog. I'm on a billboard in Times Square. Are you serious? I said. Why would I joke about something like this?
Are they allowed to put your photo on a billboard like that?
Umar asked. The contract basically says they have the right to use my image however and wherever they want, she said.
Really?
And you were okay with signing a contract like that? I said. I didn't read it very carefully before I signed, she admitted. This was typical Ghaz, plunging in headfirst without first checking the depth of the water.
Is it big?
Umar asked. It's a billboard, Ghaz cried.
Can't you ask them to take it down?
He said. I tried. No dice. They even told me I should be proud because plenty of women would kill to be on a billboard in Times Square. My parents are going to flip when they find out. They're on their way to pick me up as we speak.
Ghaz's parents were conservative, and she and her mother already had a fraught and contentious relationship. There was no doubt they would react badly, very badly. Maybe they won't find out,
Umar suggested.
I mean, how many people go to Times Square, besides tourists?
Whatever happens, Ghaz, we're here for you, I assured her. We love you, and it's all going to be okay. Hold on. I think I'm going to throw up.
A few retching sounds later.
Nope, not happening. Ugh, my mom's calling me. I gotta go.
Umar and I frowned at each other across the table, though Umar's response to almost everything was to turn it into a joke. Even he was at a loss. The prayer app on his phone went off, a sonorous male voice singing out the call to prayer. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar.
I gotta pray, namaz,
Umar said.
Can I use your room?
How can you pray at a time like this? I asked.
Times like this are when you need to pray the most, he replied. BRB.
After he left, I scanned the wine rack, selecting what was hopefully one of my mother's less expensive bottles of red. As I poured myself a glass, Shoaib walked into the dining room.
What's up? He said, removing one earbud from his ear.
What? I replied. Am I not worthy of both your ears?
He made a face, but took out the other one. Why are you drinking wine at like 3 in the afternoon?
None of your business, Sho, I said. Shoaib went by Sho because non-Desi people couldn't say his name, which was pronounced kind of like Shoaib, correctly.
Umar is ITCWHDO, isn't he?
He asked, sitting where Umar had been but taking up twice as much space. English, please, I said. Among Shuaib's annoying habits was his fondness for inventing acronyms.
In the closet with his dick out.
I hadn't told Shuaib Umar was gay. I worried his response would require me to actually start hating him. Plus, Umar wasn't out, so it wasn't my place to tell. He's not, I said.
Then why was he staring at me like he was about to jizz his shorts?
I had no good answer to this besides the truth. He rarely wears shorts, I dodged.
I have good gaydar. I knew this guy in school was gay before he even came out, and he's a jock, not your typical gay dude.
There's no such thing as a typical gay dude. He snorted, wiping down his sweaty pits with a dinner napkin embroidered by our deceased grandmother and tossing it back onto the table.
Most of the gay guys in my school are all the same. Theater geeks who travel in a pack and hit on the straight guys and tease us if we act uncomfortable, like we exist for their entertainment. But if we say anything back, then it's like we're homophobic.
I can't talk about this with you, I admonished, because each word coming out of your mouth makes me want to stuff your face in the mountain of boogers you leave behind the couch, which, by the way, you really need to vacuum.
Anyway, isn't he religious?
Shoaib continued.
I mean, his phone is singing Allahu Akbar. Can you be Muslim and gay? Isn't that like, what's the word?
Dissonant, I offered. It was true that Umar's life embodied dissonance. He tried to pray at least once a day, if not more. He didn't drink alcohol or eat pork. He believed in Allah and the Prophet, and that the Quran was the holy book. And he had always been attracted to guys. His humor sensibility ranged from corny and juvenile to shameless and lewd. He'd blow $150 on a cashmere scarf and then drive 10 minutes out of his way to save 3 cents a gallon on gas.
Hey,
Umar said, appearing in the doorway. I tensed, wondering how much of our conversation he'd heard.
What's up, Ohms?
Shoaib replied, raising his hand for a fist bump, to which Umar complied. Would you mind leaving us alone? I asked Shoaib. We have something important to discuss.
What? Is HBBC up to no good? The bank?
Umar asked. Ignore him, I insisted. HBBC was Shoaib's obnoxious acronym for Ghaz, hot but batshit crazy. She was the former, but certainly not the latter, at least not in the way he meant it. Can you get lost, please?
He shrugged. I have to take a shower anyway. Hot date. Some of us have a life.
We waited until he'd gone upstairs before speaking.
Well, I just said dua for Ghaz, that everything will turn out okay,
Umar said. In many ways, Ghaz was the strongest of the three of us, and the most stubborn. But some of her strength was rooted in denial, which also made her more vulnerable. We all had our unique versions of dissonance. How much trouble do you think Ghaz will be in over this billboard? I asked.
I don't know, he replied. How soon can we get to Times Square?
2. We took New Jersey Transit to Penn Station and the one train up to Times Square, resurfacing at 42nd Street and 7th Avenue. Instead of asking Ghazala where the billboard was, Umar suggested we try to find it ourselves. If we couldn't find it, then maybe no one else would. We began by walking up 7th Avenue to 50th Street and, seeing no sign of Ghaz, headed back down Broadway. As we walked along Broadway, I became increasingly hopeful. We'd seen ads for LG watches, Broadway musicals, the Mormon church, and Coach sunglasses, video billboards for Dunkin' Donuts and a Samsung phone, but no Ghazala in sight. Maybe she was inconspicuous, tucked away on a side street, visible only if you stood directly across from her. Maybe they'd heeded her complaint and decided to take the billboard down. We reached 46th Street, at the small pedestrian square dividing 7th Avenue from Broadway. At one end of the square was the TKTS booth, over which they'd built a series of red steps for people to lounge upon.
If we go all the way to the top of those steps, we'll get a good view,
Umar said. As we crossed the square, Umar stopped so suddenly that a huffing man in a purple pinstriped suit rammed into him. His scuffed gray briefcase fell open, a stack of handwritten papers torn from a composition notebook spilling out.
Goddamn tourists,
the man snapped. I bent down and helped him collect his papers. When I glanced up, I saw Umar hadn't moved. He was craning his neck, mouth ajar, the ends of his scarf wound boxer-like around his hands. He'd found her. Ghaz was perched above a souvenir shop, 10 feet long and on her knees, photoshopped to be even skinnier than she already was. She was wearing hot pink boy short underwear and a low-cut black tank top, one strap slipping off her shoulder. The thin fabric of her tank top revealed a silhouette of nipple. Her right hand cupped the back of her neck, her left hand cinched her waist, and her thumb was tucked into her underwear's waistband like she might be enticed to pull it down. Must tendrils framed her long, lovely face. One of them rested artfully across her collarbone. She'd been ethnically accessorized, a floral diagonal henna pattern decorating the backs of her hands, gold bangles circling one wrist, a small bindi on her forehead. Her chin was angled down slightly, her lips seductively parted. Her deep brown eyes gazed straight ahead, sultry and inviting while maintaining a youthful innocence. She encapsulated the quintessential Brooklyn attire girl, the young, beautiful virgin yearning to be ravished, this one with a touch of the exotic. She looked amazing and very sexualized. It was quite the end to her freshman year. A Japanese tourist, noticing our rapt expressions, paused to snap a photo of the billboard.
Her parents are going to flip the F out, Umar breathed. Oh, man. When she said she was going to audition, I should have told her not to do it.
You know, Ghaz. Once she's made up her mind, that's it, I reminded him. What we have to do now is help her deal with the fallout.
Umar freed his hands from his black and white giraffe print scarf, the ends falling in an X over his chest. He was almost as vain about his scarves as he was about his hair, and wore them nearly every day, even in the thick heat of summer. This makes me nervous, he confessed.
I hooked my finger around a belt loop in his jeans, pulling him close. It's Ghaz. We're there for her. She'll get through this. She always does.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.